after PhD, I worked on a project in Germany that was making a new Greek critical edition of the Book of Revelation from the New Testament. And my job was to sit alone in my office and just transcribe digital images of manuscripts all day long, 5 days a week. And as I was reading them, I noticed a set of other features that I had never paid attention to or knew that they existed. There are all sorts of marginal notes, comments, artworks, doodles, notes in different languages, all these sorts of things that seemed important for understanding how these manuscripts worked. A good way to conceptualize paratexts is that they are the features that mediate the text to readers. Just like the architectural features of a building mediate a person's experience in that building to them, and they influence what you do there and how you engage with whatever activity you're doing, it's the same thing for the paratexts. They're doorways into understanding the text and contextualizing it in a particular way. They lead you to read the text in a certain way, to conceptualize its authors and the place that it was written in a particular historical context. I wanted to try to explore one really complex gospel manuscript from the 12th century and to explore the dynamics of all of these sort of paratextual features and how they might reflect the ideas about the gospels of the people who produced it and how it might influence people who had read this particular manuscript. So the manuscript we're working on for this project is Chester Beatty, Western Collection 139. It's a 12th century deluxe Byzantine gospel codex of all four gospels. No one has ever done any significant work on this manuscript. It has almost every possible paratext of a gospel manuscript that you could find. Multiple prefaces, lexica of Hebrew words, catena, titles, segmentation systems, icons, visual art, all sorts of illuminations throughout. So it has a bit of everything. Today, most of these things are oriented either toward selling copies or fulfilling legal responsibilities of publication, but in the ancient world, the medieval world, these are oriented toward understanding the text. We think a lot about how people produce and consume content today, especially in the digital world, and in this manuscript in particular, there's a chain of commentary around the edge of almost every folio that tells people what particular words mean, or how to interpret the significance of a particular passage or strange saying. They're thinking about how to aid readers when they come to this text. So this is all related from antiquity through to the digital world. So prayers in the margin, notes, corrections to the text, all of these sorts of things reflect human engagement with the Gospels in a concrete way. The Eusebian canon tables are a set of 10 tables that were contrived in late antiquity that allow people to cross-reference related sayings in the Gospels. And this manuscript also has the letter to Carpianus in cross shape and cruciform that is instructions on how this complex cross-referencing system works. Another feature that I think is interesting in this manuscript is that it has 5 icons or full page images, 4 for each of the evangelists, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and John has his friend Prochorus who's writing for him. This manuscript also comes with liturgical notations. So within the text of the manuscript, you have notations on where and when to read particular segments of the gospel. One of the goals of this project is to locate manuscripts from all religious traditions specifically, fit into this larger philosophical idea of aesthetic cognitism, which is the idea that one of the values that artworks bring is their ability to yield knowledge to people who are using them. We tend to think of literature as the product of like one human genius, when in fact it's a collaboration of many people doing many different jobs. If you decided to ignore all paratexts, just read a naked text. One, first, I think that's physically impossible. The choices you make whether you're reading something on a screen or on a printed paper. What color is the paper? What size is it? What size is the font? What kind of abbreviations are you using? All of these are paratextual choices. They're inescapable. But if you were to try, you would lose the richness of tradition that comes along with literary works in general. Literary works are the products of authors, sure, but also of a tradition of people that have transmitted them, that have passed them on, that have read them, that have interpreted them. whether you're talking about a modern author or an ancient work like the New Testament. Paratexts are everywhere. They're ubiquitous. You can't escape them. But they're the things that are everywhere that we don't even know exist most times. And that's what makes them so powerful.